So, hello everyone. Welcome back to the second section of the academic track of State of Map 2022. My name is Hao Li and I'm from Heidelberg University. I'm gonna chair the session. So we have three talks, full talks in this session. The second one would be remote. For the first one, I would like to introduce you to Seado from the Leibniz Institute of Ecologic, Urban and Regional Development. And Seado would tell us about how to automatically derive the urban public space from OpenStreetMap data. So the floor is yours.
Thank you very much. Welcome to my presentation about the derivation of urban public green spaces from OpenStreetMap by using activity-related barriers. My name is Theodor Rieche. I'm a cartographer and spatial scientist from Dresden in Germany and working at the Leibniz Institute of Ecological Urban Regional Development. And also I'm working currently in another project. It's about accessibility analysis and public services. So it's called GeoOpen Accessibility Tool. So that's my current work. And also my interests are open data, open source, spatial AI, citizen science, and much more. This presentation is based on my master thesis, and my supervisors were Martina Müller from the University of Applied Science in Dresden and also Robert Hecht from the same Leibniz Institute I'm working right now. And also this master thesis is connected to another research project. It's called MindGrün, Information and Navigation to Urban Green Spaces. And this was a research project from 2018 to 2021, funded by the German Ministry of Traffic and Digital Infrastructure. And the main part was to have like an application about public urban green spaces to can search for the most suitable green spaces according to some criteria, like having some benches or having a good density of path network, for example, or for activities. So also the most suitable green spaces for going hiking or meeting friends, or also to play football, for example. And we did it, unfortunately, only for the pilot cities Heidelberg and Dresden, so not for the whole world, maybe it comes later. And in every case, there is needed a polygon base to store the features which are required for this search function. And this is now the focus in my study. So as a motivation, we have some official data, but it's not complete. There are several reasons why it's not complete. One is also like by the definition in the semantic way, then of course it's more than park or cemetery, for example. It could be also like brownfields or some stripes next to the roads, which also could be green. So they are more green than in the official data also. And in the first version, we use different data sources like the official data, topographic data from Germany, some data from the municipality from Dresden and Heidelberg, and also OpenStreetMap. So we have also like different data licenses. We have different fusion problematics there. And the question is now if there is a solution only by using OpenStreetMap. And also another field of research could be to consider different perception of the users, like maybe different action spaces. I will talk later to it. That also we could do some research to deal with this aspect, maybe how the users could feel in the green space during the usage. And also I want to test some modules to predict greenness and publicly accessibility. So how well is OpenStreetMap data suited for deriving publicly accessible green spaces in urban areas? And also another question I ask is which land use transitions, like from land use A to land use B, this shared line, it's the transition or the change line I call it here, and mapped in OpenStreetMap have which probability of being a barrier in the context of the study. Study area is here Dresden plus a 5 kilometer buffer. So in Eastern Germany it's located, and the data source is OpenStreetMap as the main data source. And also as reference data, I use some official cadastral data having this usage information in Germany, and also some cadastral parcels of the city of Dresden, which was a result from request in the city council. It was asked to get information of all parcels owned by the city of Dresden to make some plans for the future. And also we have this data here for Dresden. Now I want to come to a definition of an activity-related barrier in the context of the study. So of course, like the physical ones, like such as walls, fences, or hedges are included, like what you know from OpenStreetMap from the barrier key. And then I want to introduce the action space or of doing one activity. Then you want to play football, you're looking for a green space maybe or a suitable space, and you play football there, but something maybe is limiting you. So you look for a large enough field to do it, and maybe then there is a river or there is some hedge or and so on, and then it's clear, okay, this is the place where I can play football and beyond not. And important for the application I mentioned before is to separate the screen spaces in a good way, like to find good barriers, that the result of the search of the application found also suitable polygons of green spaces that it makes sense to play football in this or in this area. So the action space is limited by a barrier. And then I want to divide the activities having the application implemented in two different versions, like stationary and in motion, I called it here. And stationary activities, I mean like playing football, for example, or some different, so you look for one place and you stay there. And in motion could be, for example, go hiking, go jogging, go by bike, and so on. So when you're moving on the line, and this is something different maybe in context of these barriers then. Roads, railroads, and waterways are sure to be a barrier. And on the other hand, trails and like this mentioned change of land use, like this transitions, it's uncertain knowledge right now of being a barrier in the context of the activity. Then to simplify it, I just concentrate on the stationary activities, so it makes it more easier just to have like the idea of playing football in your mind and not going by bike, because it's different if there is a gate and a wall and so on, so then it could be a different situation then. And also to point out the conceptual framework, extend the definition of OpenStreetMap barrier, so it's more also than barrier key of OpenStreetMap. And here you have some examples on the left side, for example, the flower bed. So it could be here like a change from land use also, and it's maybe not a good idea to play football over this flower bed here. On the right side, some wooden bollards here, it depends. So for some activities, it could be a barrier, for other not, just to give you an idea. Then I come to my methodology. First, I derive some barrier types from OpenStreetMap. After that, I have also the derivation of land use layer to have a good topological layer without holes and overlaps to find out if shared lines between land use A and B I can use later then. The third step is to do a ground truth for selected areas in Dresden to map by type for selected types, the occurrence, is it a barrier or not, just in a subjective way, based on my definition I gave before. And after that, I determine if it's a barrier or not to calculate the probability by type. I will explain it later. And the next step is to generate a polygon mesh based on all those lines. And after that, conclusion to apply some modules for greenness and publicly accessibility on the generated polygons. Technical implementation is open source, so it's based on Ubuntu, and also I'm happy with using Docker containers as a dev environment, so I have different Docker containers for Python, for PostGIS database, for OSM to PostgreSQL, for example, to input the data, so it's, for me it's a nice environment to have different packages in the containers and to implement this study. So the first step, as I mentioned, is derivation of barrier types on OpenStreetMap. And here in the green color labeled on the left side, I have roads, railroads, waterways, and barriers, like the barrier key. This is should be a barrier. And red colored is like trails and change of land use, which is uncertain. Here you can see the key values I used. So quite a lot in some parts here. Also in the bottom part, you can see I also deal with some specific cases like to remove the bridges and tunnels again because it's not then a barrier, or to deal with steps because it could be connected to a trail or to a street. So I also figured out the adjacent line segment showing or seeing which highway key value is used there. And then I can decide if the step itself belongs to the trail or the street, for example. So to explain some cases here. Here you can see the barriers as well. And the second step in the methodology is then to create this land use layer. So also we heard before in the lightning talk, there is this nice option from osmlandus.org. It's here my option A. And then I just figured out another option B from IOER monitor. And also in both cases, I have a topology and I can map the OSM land use key values into these new topologies. And so also the number of all combinations between land use is also less than it would be only with a lot of OSM keys. And so I can also say that option B, I used about 350, I guess, to 400 something in this range OSM key values. So also I decided to take later option B because it's more detailed than I found 1 year ago. It was the time for master thesis from osmlandus.org. So that's why I decided then to take option B. And here we have no holes and no overlap. So I have also a ranking. It's also based on this typology. It's given by the topology, which is on the upper level and on the lower level. And also I add the usual class also for all holes because there are some areas which are not covered by OpenStreetMap, but also I did not take any external data. I just say it is another class. Here, for example, you can see again land use. And now I took only this mentioned lines between land use A and B to have a line layer. And I go to the next step to ground truth to selected areas in Dresden, like the city park, Großer Garten in German, and also Newtown, two different parts I decided to map. And I concentrate on the trails and on the land use changes because it's uncertain knowledge, is it a barrier or not? And I did it with the QField app. So I prepared a form giving me some valid values like yes, no, no data. No data also if I could not reach it because it's private. So then I just said it's no data and I could also do it there. And here you can see some numbers of the mapped objects. So it's quite a lot, I guess. Also on the right side, you have screenshots here from QField app. And after this mapping, I calculated the barrier probability. So is it a barrier or not, weighted on line length. So all line segments for different trial types or land use change combinations. For each of these types, I calculated then the probability. And here you can see the results. So on the left side, the land use changes and I guess there are a lot of combinations having the selected areas in Dresden, but of course not all. So there would be much more of this. I also have another chart, but not in this presentation, showing me all combinations. But it's also a lot, and many of them are 100% sure to be a barrier in my subjective judgment rating about it. But also on the right side of the left chart, you can see also as well there are others. For example, with the lowest probability, it's forest to grassland. I'm sorry, it's in German. I did the master thesis in German. Also, the labels of the typology are in German. On the right side, we have the trial types like cycleway, track, footway, and path. And here, the cycleway I found in the selected areas always to be a barrier, for example, for playing football and so on. For the path, it was less, more than 80%. Also, you can see here this result. Next step is to generate a polygon mesh. And so I took now from a part from Dresden, from a bounding box, I created all lines like all the streets, the railroads, the waterways, all barrier key having OpenStreetMap already, and then this now trails and land use changes. And so I called it a line pool. And I add some attributes like for buffer, because also buffer is also important here to have different buffer ranges. And so I could deal with motorway and not motorway from highway or tram and not tram, for example. Also here I could go more in detail, but this is maybe an easy approach just to present some different buffer values. And also I have this likelihood, that this probability of being a barrier. And for those who are sure to be a barrier, I said one. And for trails and land use change, it comes from the mapping from the ground truth I did before. The second step is then the polygon mesh. And just to think about these different action spaces, which is a side part of the research, I took it from different intervals from the barrier probability. So I'll show later then in the next slide. You can see here on the left side and the right side is both the same area, so the six charts left and on the right is the same. But you have different base of lines like barriers included. So here, like in the upper left, I took every, so also with the left BM probability being a barrier. And here the lower right chart in the middle, only those who have 100% probability being a barrier. And as you can see the differences, okay, the polygons are less, have less area or larger area. And also this could be a way later in the application. It's not implemented yet, but maybe we have two or three different versions of polygons as a search base for the search function and application, also to deal with different activities. So then when you search for activity football, maybe you took this polygon base and for another, also another base. So it's complex, I know, and also that the technical implementation later would be not easy, but this could be one approach there. And then I come to prediction of publicly accessibility. It's just an easy model to count some POIs containing the polygons, like point in polygon, and like number of benches, waste baskets, public toilets, and internet for publicly accessibility. And as a reference, I took this cadastral parcels owned by the city of Dresden, I mentioned in the beginning of the presentation, and also I assume those cadastral parcels also will be publicly accessible. And here, this is just a result on my logistic regression, and so I have here 430 polygons in this bounding box having are being publicly accessible, the other not. And so the result is in some parts it's good, and I can find it also as a good result, but in other areas, of course, something must also be improved there. And I did it also for other classifiers and have the score. And then the next module to predict the queerness, I took a similar but a different selection of POIs like benches, picnic tables, trees, and waste baskets. And here, like this cadastral data from Germany, having this land use information. And I said this like for its forest, scrubs, cemetery, sport, leisure, and recreation areas. So these categories from the reference data set, I assume to be green, and also to the same procedure. Having here the result applied to the generated polygons, having here a better intrinsic score. And yeah, then I want to come to the conclusion and the outlook. So I guess it's an interesting approach how we could generate some urban green spaces in a new way. And so there are some good results and could be also more research in the future. And for example, some points would be XGBoost as a new algorithm, also for the machine learning module in the end, and maybe to do grid search for finding the best parameters. And of course, a good point would here to have more features. There are quite a lot of ideas how we could generate or derive some input features of the polygons. For example, also path density. We could include other POIs. We could input features creating from geometry, from typology, from to the relation to other objects or also to other data sets. So there are a lot of ideas what we could do there. And then we could also analyze the feature importance, which of these features affects in the most way the accuracy of the model. So this could be done also. And also remote sensing would be one point we could add to find out the greenness based on remote sensing data. And also we could do it for further cities and also the ground truth, the mapping, also maybe for other areas, it would be also an idea. Then also maybe it's interesting which return we could have to OpenStreetMap community and the project. And one idea could be to analyze the completeness of barriers, also of the barrier key. So maybe this could be an idea also depending on the land use transitions I mentioned, maybe to say, okay, there is a assistant layer also in this case to figure out, to browse, where maybe a barrier key could be added based on land use or based on other input data here. Also another idea would be to create assistant layer also for land use to complete here the data. And Another point could be the open space routing. So when your routing algorithm goes through a polygon, there are different algorithms here to find the best way through a polygon, which is important for different navigation aspects. And also here, information about this barrier probability could help for better routing. And also this publicly accessibility is also here could be a part in this analysis. Then thank you for your attention, and now you can ask.
thank you, Theodor, for your nice presentation. Are there any questions? I will first go from the venue list questions. Yeah. There was currently one. Would you make the urban green space data and method open source somewhere online? Might be interesting to test it in other cities.
Yeah, good question. So you can see here on the last slide, I have a link, so it's on GitHub. So then you can figure it out. But otherwise, please write me an email if you have any question. Then, so like the algorithm is already there, the data not. It could be for the feature.
Okay, so your method with algorithms is also available.
Like... It's available, yes. The data, of course, it's open source, so that's not, but I have some intermediate process data. I could also publish maybe somewhere on Zenodo or maybe on GitHub. So this is not included right now, but the methods and also the code, the source code.
Nice. So any other questions from audience?
Hi, thank you so much. It was a great presentation. I just want to clarify. So you mentioned that it's quite hard to define a green space because it's not just parks. Could you elaborate a little bit more? Because you mentioned this, but I didn't really catch how you defined it. Did you rely on some policy papers? Did you conduct interviews with people? Like, how did it go? Thank you.
Okay, I mentioned this research project like MeinGrün, and there we did a lot of research, also some questionnaires and so on. And so then when you mentioned like you want to go to the next green space to spend some time there, you have not only the parks, it depends maybe from city to city it could be, but you have other places which are accessible and it's allowed to use it. Of course, this are some would be some limitations then. And and then it depends. We found out different criteria, so we asked also in this research project for which activities, which requirements are important. And also this goes into this the thinking about it. And like as I said, some brownfields, some vacant land could be also some other green you can find, which is not in the official data. So maybe not in OpenStreetMap, that's also could also be, but also not in the official data sets of the municipalities. Mostly you have like parks and green spaces which are owned by the city maybe. And then of course you have cemeteries, you have sports, you have other like allotments and so on. Maybe you can use for going hiking through allotment, but not the area then. And for all these reasons, it could be interesting to look also for the other green spaces.
Thank you. I see another question here.
Thank you, an excellent presentation, really interesting project. There's a lot of interest in green space mapping in the United Kingdom. Our national mapping agency, the Ordnance Survey, who have their own structured map, have been extracting green space. And likewise, the data science lab at the Office for National Statistics has been trying to quantify green space. So I didn't see those in your references, but they are.
Thanks for the hint. It's new to me, but thanks. I will figure it out then.
Yeah, they're both worth looking at. Did you use any remote sensing data? Because what you've got here is a nice opportunity to classify remote sensing images and to see what the relationship is.
Yeah, as I mentioned in the outlook, it would be the best also to prove it, the greenness with the remote sensing data. You're right. There was a last talk 3 years ago here, also in short term, having the Sentinel-2 remote data. And also we ended this research project, we had it also as an external raster layer. You're right, this is also to calculate the percentage of green of each polygon. You could just count maybe the cells of the raster layer. It's also an approach to do that. Yes.
Very nice presentation. Thank you.
Maybe more questions? Okay. So I see a follow-up here, so we have Yosh for sure.
Thank you. Yeah, just a quick question. Because you are talking about accessibility and all these things, and I wonder if you thought about connectivity, how easy it is, or for example, how green spaces, how well they are connected to other points of interest, maybe residential areas if it's a park.
Yeah. It's also a nice topic. It was not topic of this master thesis, but also I said, like I'm working now in another project, like Geo Open Accessibility Tool. It's called GOAT project, and it's about all this accessibility question and how is the quality of life and also like 15-minute city, for example, to mention it. And also there we have one module in this project addressing your questions for which target groups, maybe for older people, for young sports. People and so on, having you enough supply with green spaces and also some connectivity. How is the connectivity between different green spaces? Yeah, it's an important point.
Okay, so thank you.